remember him coming to me one day, and he had one of these, and I remember looking at him. I said, "Are you crazy?" I said, "These things are killing me." He said, "Jay, I promise it won't hurt you. Just do half of it." He said. So I ended up doing half of it. From that day on, I fell in love with oxycodone. Powerful pain pill that would take me to depths and something. So, you know, there I had the, now I had the marijuana addiction. Now I had a pain pill addiction. I had a little girl my senior year of high school. So now I got a kid. And reality was I couldn't even take care of myself. Now here I got a kid to take care of. And that's how I come out of high school. So, you know, and the one thing I've seen my dad do over the years was work. All he done was work. So that instilled in me that, you know, just keep working. And I don't know, man. I don't know how I ever, by the grace of God, I guess, I held down a job as long as I did, and as many jobs as I did hold down, because I had some good jobs through all that. And I would, around 2006, I would get a job on the Navy base, sandblasting and coating our Navy vessels. I spent some time in Jacksonville, from Jacksonville all the way up to Rhode Island, Connecticut, all up down the East Coast, and I went from Bremerton, Seattle, all the way from Puget Sound Naval Shipyard all the way to San Diego. Now I got to see it, and by the time I was 28 years old, I'd been almost everywhere in the States with this habit. I was making good money, so you know I could somewhat afford my habit, but at the same time I had to always rely back on my dad, because this is what my dad done all the years, and you know, he had a big name in the business because he'd been in it 30 something years. So you know, it led me to this job to you know, I could provide it for my family with ease if I didn't have the addiction problem. So I ended up in 2008, I ended up in San Diego Naval Shipyard there at Nasco Steel, and by that time, I'd been in the business there a couple, two or three years. By that time, I was running a night shift. I was a night shift foreman. So I had my own crew, and I really didn't have nobody over me on night shift, so I could pretty much come and do what I pleased. So, you know, and Tijuana was, you could get on the trolley right there at the naval station, and you could be over in Tijuana in about 20 minutes. So, you know, I began to, if I didn't send somebody, I began running back and forth and getting pills out of Tijuana. And, you know, I'll never forget it, because it was like, you know, you had that fear of getting caught and doing these things. And there was a big 30-year imprisonment sign there. But at the same time, I couldn't quit doing it, if that makes sense. I was so, the obsession was so real and so strong. Nothing in my power, nothing I could do, or nothing in my power, or anything else in this world could take this away. I tried everything. I've been to methadone clinics. I've been to Suboxone clinics, you name it, all these other drugs, trying to get people off drugs, you know, and it didn't work. So, you know, I come back home. My mom, bless her heart, she's the only one I can honestly say that never give up hope on me. My mom was there for it all, and she's still that rock today. And I don't know what I'd do without her. But anyway, I brought my brother out there to San Diego. On the next, this was the second job. I come in for a little while, I think for Christmas, and I went back out, and I took my brother with me this time, and I got him a job out there. And this is the person that, you know, things we done, you know, it was so toxic, really. And today, you know, I see that, but at the time I couldn't see it, blinded, you know. It's such a, I don't know, it's just so self-consuming. Like, you can't see outside of yourself when this is going on. You really can't. You can't see a solution or a way out of it. I actually thought at one point in my life that this is the way my life was going to be, and I was going to die like this. This is actually what came to mind. And I remember it. And I remember my brother, he ended up coming out there with me. We both got all strung out there on Oxycontin. And, you know, I remember we had to do a job in the crow's nest of a battleship on that. And we was up in the top of it, and me and him both was up there. And I remember him looking over at me, and I looked over at him. And we didn't have no medicine that night, is what it all boiled down to. And I remember him, and he said, "Are you thinking what I'm thinking?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "We are to just jump." And this thing's dry docked in the shipyard at about 200 foot an hour. And I remember those thoughts going through my mind to just end it, because I was that miserable, and he was too. That's a place, a lonely place that, I don't know, it's hard to put into words. It's a loneliness that few know. And, you know, I can recall those times, that loneliness. And, you know, I remember being in my house with my family, everybody home, everybody sitting right there with me. And I couldn't acknowledge none of them. I was so trapped in myself, so isolated within myself. I couldn't talk to them. I couldn't do any of that. I was sitting there for days and days. I remember that very well. You know, so isolated, so trapped up in self, in the bondage of self. It was unreal. So, anyway, Mom would send us plane tickets, and she flew us home. She'd talk to Dad, and Dad told her how bad off he was and this and that. And, you know, my mom would send us plane tickets. This was in 2010, I think. So she flew us both home. And I think when I got home, he went to a treatment center in Virginia. I went to a treatment center in Bowling Green, Kentucky. So, I ended up finishing the center I was in, and he'd left 2 weeks, about 2 weeks into his treatment, he'd come back home. So, of course, by the time I get home, he's already relapsed, and he's already doing his thing here, running with the same people, doing the same things. And, you know, I mean, I get it, because, you know, that's what we've done all of our life, and these are the people that, you know, that we've grown up with and stuff. And at the same time, I went a different route there for a while. I think I ended up going back to Clearfield Church, which is my home church, back down to Clearfield Church. And, you know, I stuck around there. I moved my letter there, and I stuck around there for the next several years under a harsh parting. One of the greatest men I ever known. And you know, I learned so much from Harsh Parton and some of the other elders there. But what I found out is that, you know, I couldn't do it alone. It took the church. It took people that's doing the will of God to give me hope that I could overcome it. I know that today. You know, without help, it's just too much. So, you know, if anybody's struggling with any kind of, you know, wanting to take their life or anything like that, just reach out for help. Because I know what it's like to try to do that on your own. Without help, it's too much. And I know that today. So I come home from the treatment center, and I get back in church, and, you know, I go back to work. By this time, I'd pretty much lost about So I go back to work trying to reestablish my life and some of the things I lost in my life. And I think I stayed sober for maybe 18 months, somewhere around there. And I was at work one night, and I don't know, something just flipped. And I ended up taking all just the Lord said, and something in my mind.